The title of this video is a clin-day to J.J. McCullough, who just did a kind of casual survey of the political history of France. One figure in that history who was of tremendous importance and kind of got short shrift is Napoleon III. And despite his name, Napoleon III, really he is the second, not the third, important Napoleon in history. Napoleon III is one of the most important and the most overlooked historical figures in the history of the world. Not just France, the whole world. And I'm going to make this video briefly to break down for you why that is. Point one, there is a tendency in the writing, promotion, and reception of history to focus almost exclusively on extreme leaders and flashpoints that throw contrasting parties into clear relief. So what do I mean by this? If you're going to teach a high school history course, for the most part, what those courses focus on are people like Adolf Hitler and Joseph Stalin. They consciously or unconsciously, the people who are designing these courses fasten on to extreme figures, extreme stereotypes, and moments of conflict that can sometimes conceal history more than they reveal it, but I guess they give a kind of pleasing moral to the story for the students in the classroom. Now, you know, by contrast, with any one of those historical periods, there's no interest in presenting the students with a selection of typical leaders of France, typical leaders of Germany before, after, or during, you know, these kind of flashpoints of history. Well, you know, what was the sense even of a typical member of parliament? You know, someone who wasn't the number one leader, but a contending voice who was making moderate proposals for some kind of ameliorative change. In the same way, I think now Napoleon III's importance is forgotten because of his mediocrity. But mediocrity is not incompatible with tremendous historical significance. Maybe just the contrary. Maybe actually it's the mediocre people who really make history in this world, not the extraordinary ones, not the exceptions to the rule. So that's point one. Point two, part of Napoleon III's extraordinary significance is precisely the inspirational effect he had on people like Karl Marx. And when I say people like Karl Marx, I don't just mean Karl Marx. I mean all the people in the history of Europe, especially in the century following after the career of Napoleon III, all the people who sat down and wrote a book and fantasized that the popularity and influence of their book would catapult them into a position of real political power. Because that is exactly what happened to Napoleon III. It's a little bit too easy to tell the story, as J.J. McCullough did, as if Napoleon III was born into power. He was not. Napoleon III's rise to power was 100% because of a book he wrote. And the book, very significantly, is called The Extinction of Pauperism. You might see the title smoothed over to be something more like The End of Poverty or The End of Vagrancy. But what I see mostly used in English today is The Extinction of Pauperism. Now, again, imagine you're a young Karl Marx, and you look at this. You say, wow, here's this guy. He led a series of failed attempts at coup d'etat, failed attempts at revolution, you could put it that way. Those went nowhere. Those accomplished nothing for this guy. They accomplished nothing except they got him put in prison. Okay, so that's one lesson for a young Karl Marx, for any young aspiring politician or revolutionary. You know, you get a bunch of guys with guns in the streets, you end up getting killed or put in prison. That's lesson number one. Lesson number two is, once this guy was in prison, what did he do? Napoleon III was sent to a prison that had an extraordinarily good library. He sat down in the library and he wrote a book that was a hit book and that made him into a major politician. He ends up getting elected and his story proceeds from there. All right. Now, this book, of course, is, to some extent, it's an erudite book. To some extent, you know, it's popular because of the quality of the research and writing that went into it. But the book is primarily popular because it tells people something they want to hear. And this is also, see, I'm using Karl Marx as the example because Karl Marx went on to be a very influential historical figure in his own right. even in China, even in India, even in Mexico, all over the world, far beyond France and Germany. But you've got to realize Karl Marx also responds to this as a kind of negative competition. So how does Napoleon III get himself out of jail and catapult himself from obscurity to one of the most powerful political leaders in the world? All right. He makes promises that he's going to help the poor. And he does this on the basis of a kind of tradition of common sense that goes back to Aristotle and goes back to a school of economics and philosophy called the Physiocrats that today nobody talks about. So there's another kind of mediocre political philosophy that's been forgotten. It's not as extreme as Stalin or Adolf Hitler, so it just kind of gets left out of the high school history books, gets left out of the practical discussions we have these days. And that's unfortunate. Maybe we could learn more by studying the history of some of the kind of practical, down-to-earth reformers, both those who succeeded and those who failed, rather than only studying the most extreme flashpoints in the history of the world. Okay? So what's threatening to someone like Karl Marx, the negative lesson he's learning here, is that Napoleon III is ultimately offering a completely non-revolutionary way to help the poor. He's saying, hey, 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 Aristotle had this real simple idea. If you want the poor to not be poor, you give them land ownership. You take people who are now paupers and vagrants or revolutionary rabble-rousers or people who've just become unemployed because somebody closed down a factory or closed down a mine, whatever the situation is, you give them land, they become farmers, or maybe they own a small workshop on that land or something, like maybe they carve wood to make some kind of product, whatever. You give them land, they become landowners, and then of course they become committed members of the establishment, they become part of the system, they become positive, productive members of society, they no longer want to lead a revolution and tear down society. So Karl Marx looks at this. Marx and a whole generation of intellectuals, they look at this and think, the fantasy about writing a hit book and ending up being the most powerful person in Europe, one of the most powerful, that fantasy appeals to them. But the fantasy of helping the poor in a way that would preserve the establishment and the status quo, that they don't like at all. And I would put here, I'd put forward here the assertion that one of the reasons why Karl Marx committed to this ludicrously pessimistic view of history, that only violence would work, only revolution would work, there was no point having the aristocrats help the poor, was precisely that what Louis Napoleon, known as Napoleon III, whatever you want to say here, that Napoleon III, he represented precisely a kind of aristocrat helping the poor. That was exactly the combination, that was the public policy promise that catapulted Napoleon III from obscurity into political power. Karl Marx's ideology ultimately was the product of a process of free market competition. He'd be the last person to admit it. If you read Marx's work, you can see there's an earlier stage where he's competing with Bruno Bauer and he's competing with Max Stirner. And that's how he meets Engels, and they publish a book together called The Holy Family, believe it or not, bizarre title for the text. Karl Marx witnesses the success in his time of a guy named Feuerbach, Wesen des Christentums. That book is a smash hit. And Feuerbach goes from poverty and obscurity to being like a household name. His book was such a hit, housewives were sitting around and discussing over the dinner table. And Karl Marx thinks, me too. He wants to jump on that bandwagon. But by far, I think the single most important influence on Karl Marx, both positively and negatively, is looking at the example of the rise to power of Napoleon III and thinking, wow, here's an example of someone who played a game with ideas, who wrote a book about politics promising to uplift the poor, and in return, the poor lifted him into a position of dictatorial power. That was Karl Marx's fantasy. That is the fantasy of a great many struggling, impoverished young authors.